Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, is it visible?
Divya, can you see me?
Yes, ma'am, I can see you.
Okay. So here, Aarti ma'am, Aarti Sankar ma'am, Dr. Aarti
Hello,
ma'am.
ma'am. Good afternoon.
Hello. Good
And
afternoon.
Dr. Suma, I mean Suma.
Hi, good
Good
afternoon.
afternoon, ma'am. Hello.
You can introduce yourself.
I'm Divya Guruswamy, and I'm an alumni of BMS College. I passed out just this year. So we had done a project in the final semester on algorithm for autonomous vehicle.
Wait 1 minute. I have to introduce both our chairs. So today we have Dr. Aarti R. Sankar, Associate Professor, Department of ECE. She has the area of specialization as wireless communication, and she has few research grants also, 20 lakhs of EGST and 40 lakhs of TechEB. And she has good numbers of publications also, research publications, both published in journal and international conferences. So we welcome you, ma'am, for the session, for the virtual paper presentation session. And we have the other chair for our session is Dr. M.N. Suma, Associate Professor, Department of ECE. And ma'am has the area of specialization again wireless communication, and she also has quite good number of research publications both in international journal and conferences. Ma'am also has VGST grant for 20 lakhs and again TechEB grant for 40 lakhs. So we welcome you, ma'am, for the session. So formally we can start the session now. Divya, you can continue now.
Okay, ma'am. So we had done a final year project on algorithm for autonomous vehicle control.
So Divya, for 10 minutes you have to present, and
Yes.
with question and answer it should be within 15 minutes.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
So we had done the project on autonomous vehicle control, and we have presented a paper today with the same heading. Our main objective was to analyze the video which we got through a vehicle in a human sense. Most of the analysis usually done are through neural networks, where the network learns what the system is doing and then acts accordingly. But we wanted to learn the video in a logical sense as a human would perceive the video. So first we took in video with and then we reduced the resolution so that our processing can be done at a faster speed. The block diagram is seen in the slide 3, where initially we take the road video and then we reduce the resolution, and then we read each of the frames from the video, and then we perform color segmentation. Why color segmentation is so that we can separate the road region and our surroundings, which from the image which we get from the video. The main color segmentation problem that we faced when using the inbuilt function from MATLAB was that it just fixed one threshold and it performed the color segmentation based on that threshold. But when you take an image from the video of a car or a vehicle driving on the road, there are intensity changes from objects that are closer to your vehicle and objects that are really far from the vehicle. So to even evaluate the video, even when those intensity changes were there, we could not just process the video with one threshold. We had to have different thresholds at each row in the image. But defining the thresholds without knowing anything about the image is really tough. So we scan the image from the top vertically on each column to find the limits of our road region. And then we got the threshold within which our road region is present in each of the rows. After doing that, we scan the road again from the left to right, row-wise, with our threshold kept in mind so that the segmentation is done based on the thresholds on each row, and so our processing is more robust to changes with intensity and viewing changes. So once that was done, we got an image where our road region was highlighted, and the obstacles within that did not have a threshold, did not have pixel values within our threshold, so they were not highlighted. Just the road region was highlighted. But even when this was done, the white lanes within the road were not could not be obtained optimally for us, and we just had a gray region of the road. So to find the white lanes of the road, we did Hopf transform with again scanning. The problem with Hopf transform that we faced was when the roads are curved, you cannot detect the edges because Hopf transform obtains straight lines and not curved lines. So we did scanning and we fixed a range. That the range is so that we know the white lanes, when they are closer to our vehicle, they are wider, but when they are farther, they are thinner. So we calculate the number of pixels within each row which is white. Then we compare it with our predicted value for the white lanes. When it matches or it is within a range, then we say that it is a white lane and it is not a object. Because just by comparing white threshold, we cannot fix it as a white lane, because even white cars that are inside the road region can come as white regions, but they are not white lanes. So we did that, and after doing that, we applied Hopf transform to find the corners of the edges. This just got us the white lanes and not the edge of the road. The edge of the road had to be again done through Hopf transform, because there were edges where we had black and white road markings, which also were detected. But the car cannot go to that and hit it. So it had to stay within that region. So we did a Hopf transform to limit the region. Once that was done, we got the whole road region. And then we had to scan for the obstacle. Once the road is already obtained, it's very easy to scan to find out the obstacle, because it's just a subtraction and a little of logical operations with the image we got. Then we did blob analysis by fixing a minimum area above which, if the obstacle is there, then it's an obstacle, because there are points where we get wrong pixel values based on Hopf transform and the road region because of the black and white objects on the sides on the road markings. So to avoid that, we did a minimum area blob analysis above which, if the object is there, then it is considered as an object. Once that is done, we got the X and Y values of the object, and we used this for the distance mapping. The distance mapping was done by taking an initial picture of the road and then calculating the original distance in the image and mapping that original distance to what the pixel values were there on the image. Then we got an exponential equation, which equation was used to map the pixel values that we got in our frame to the original image. We do not need the original exact distance as such, because our vehicle has to act optimally before, in advance. It should not go really close to the obstacle and then react to the distance because of the distance. So we obtained the distance mapping in our pixels, and we said, okay, if the obstacle is more than 10 pixels far, then you don't have to brake immediately. So we map the distance again to the pixels to limit our range of braking and steering angle calculation. Once that was done, we had to calculate the steering angle and the braking. Braking was essentially written as a rough code where if you're doing a steering angle, then you have to brake to avoid immediate changes. And if the braking has to be done when there are a lot of obstacles in the image and you have to avoid well in advance and there is no way that you can steer your way through the obstacles. Next, the steering angle was done by considering how much distance is available between the obstacle and the white lane markings. This was done again by considering the Y pixel of the obstacle and the white lane marking next to it by scanning and finding the number of pixels between them. This number of pixels were mapped again to the number of pixels that we need when the obstacle reaches at that point. If the number of pixels available was more than how much we would need, then we can steer in that direction and avoid the obstacle. So we found the midpoint of that distance and calculated the angle from our midpoint of the frame to that. That was the steering angle as defined. If the distance available is not enough for our obstacle to go, then we just said that it's not available. So you just keep going straight and apply a brake so that you don't go and hit that obstacle. And if there were multiple obstacles and there were no white lanes in between, we found the distance between two obstacles next to each other and found if the distance between them was optimal for us and we could fit in that. Again, the steering angle was calculated in the same way and we defined the steering angle there in terms of degrees. Once that was done, we had the steering angle, brake control and our distance, and we have plotted the measurements for different results and for the whole video. The results can be seen on slide 10, where the process is defined by getting the input and then the color segmentation, and the results at each point in the algorithm is shown there. That's it, ma'am.
Question from my side.
Yes, ma'am.
What is the delay involved in computation, because it is a dynamic condition? So how is it taken care? What is the parameter that you have considered for cost function?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, the frames that we were getting were at 26 frames per second, but our processing was done at one frame per second, which is very, very slow compared to the frames that we were getting. But the implementation problem was because of MATLAB and the processing done through MATLAB. So if it is ported to another environment where it is done through C or a different language, then the speed will definitely be improved.
And what is the different types of vehicles that you have considered, because the width and then it will also matter, right? So what,
yes,
is the, what is the set that you have considered for
The videos which we have taken are always from the same vehicle, which is a bike traveling on the road. And we have considered a few videos where there's just one single object on the road and where there are multiple objects on the road. Both the cases have been analyzed and the pictures have been posted accordingly on the paper.
So the last question is, what is the implementation issue that you think in a real-time scenario that can come, because now for the better algorithm would have been the Kalman filtering, Kalman algorithm for a dynamic situation. Have you tried with that and then compared?
No, ma'am, we haven't tried it, compared it with Kalman filter, because we wanted to do an algorithm that analyzes more like a human just by seeing the video and not by doing anything else. This algorithm has a little issues, mainly when the image is not very clear in scenarios where there is fog or in night setting, and when the road is curved quite fast or hairpin bends. In those cases, there are problems, but these things can be fixed by more optimizing the algorithm in the future times.
Good effort.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot.
Hello, Vidya. Questions from my side would be, the first one is, would you consider the velocity of the vehicle?
No, ma'am. We have not considered the velocity of the vehicle now. But again, the velocity can be calculated relatively and not the particular velocity of our vehicle.
Yeah, if not precise, from the human perception point of view, you can see if there are more than one vehicle coming. So there's a relative speed difference, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Considered any of those things?
No, ma'am. Our relative speed has not been considered here, because they are in the future implementations, because the velocity of our vehicle we can get directly from our accelerometer. And now we have written an algorithm to find the distance between the obstacle and our vehicle. So that can be implemented further to find the relative velocity of different vehicles with respect to our object.
Okay. And regarding the road also, you are mentioning about the curvature of the road and all that stuff. So if there is an inclination in the road, have you considered it anywhere?
the inclination of the road, it will be detected like how our camera would detect if our camera is tilted. But it will not differentiate if our camera is tilted or if the road is inclined and we have to turn accordingly. That has not yet been handled. But the inclination of the road will be again shown in the same way as the white lanes and the edges of the road and objects there. That's it.
Okay, fine. And have you considered anything about the weather conditions?
No, ma'am. Weather conditions and fog conditions, they have to be handled in the future scope.
Okay, fine. Yeah, it's a good work.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Divya.
Thank you, ma'am.
We'll move on to the next participant, next presenter. So you can take care.
Yeah,
Hello,
madam.
Sugandha, can you hear me?
Hello, good afternoon, madam.
Yeah, only audio is coming. There is no video connectivity here.
Video.
Okay. But it's quite dark. It is.
Is it now, madam?
Yeah, this is better now. So myself, Kitisri Mishra, Assistant Professor, Department of ECE, BMSC.
Good afternoon.
We have two session chairs today with us here. Dr. Arti R. Sankar, Associate Professor, Department of ECE. And we have Dr. Amin Suma, Associate Professor, Department of ECE, BMSC. Yeah. So you can start with your presentation.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Good afternoon, madam. This is Sugandha Tanjan. I am presenting a paper on enhancing computational accuracy and performance of interval arithmetic double rotation quadratic algorithm.
Yeah, continue.
Yes, ma'am. So the contents are, I will be starting with introduction, literature survey, objectives, interval arithmetic quadratic algorithms, possible outcomes, applications, and references. So introduction. So real scientific computations require numerically intensive calculations. So in this type of calculations, we come across inaccurate results. And in this inaccurate results, we see roundup errors and approximation errors. And in order to handle these roundup errors and approximation errors, we use a technique called interval arithmetic, which works for a period of values rather than a fixed value and ensures that exact solution lies in this interval. So in order to control these errors, we go for interval arithmetic technique. Along with this, in our work, we are using interval arithmetic in conjunction with quadratic algorithm. And we know with the advent of VLSI technology, so many hardware efficient algorithms have come into picture. So what we do is, in order to exploit the full potential of interval arithmetic, floating point interval arithmetic technique, we use quadratic algorithm in conjunction with interval arithmetic, whereas quadratic algorithm is a class of shift and odd add algorithm for rotating vectors in a plane, which is used for the calculations of trigonometric functions, hyperbolic functions, etc. So these are the literature survey which I have done. So I have done from the beginning. This is some of the literature survey which I have put. Only for simplicity, I have just picked few. I started with the introduction of the Wolder, 1959, followed by 1996 by Antelo et al. And interval arithmetic method, which is a conventional reliable alternative to floating point arithmetic. So we can use these applications in various applications in signal processing window. So these are some of the objectives. Design analysis of quadratic interval arithmetic in rotational mode. and followed by design and analysis of interval arithmetic double rotation coordinate method for improving accuracy. So what are the issues or challenges which is affecting our design? So the issues or challenges which are affecting the design are low computational accuracy, high computational latency, and low throughput rate. So in order to tackle these issues or challenges, so I have designed interval arithmetic quadratic architecture. I have started with mathematical calculations. These mathematical calculations followed by algorithms, and later on I have done algorithm to architecture mapping. And once I have done architecture mapping, I have done this using MATLAB toolbox INCLAB. So INCLAB is used for validating the algorithm. So these are the results which I got from MATLAB toolbox INCLAB. So here I found for performance analysis. For performance analysis, I used a concept for relative error. Relative error is which gives a forecast of interval arithmetic performance analysis, which is given by the expression actual value minus simulation divided by simulation into 100. So I have found for trigonometric functions like sine and cos. So if you know sine and cos, we can easily calculate all the auxiliary functions like sine, cosec, tan, sec, and all. So hence I have found for sine 45 and cos 45. The relative error which I got was 0.000168 for sine 45 and 0.000167 for cos 45. And the next one which I have designed, this is the architecture for double rotation interval arithmetic quadratic. So here the rotation of the quadratic is accelerated to be 2 theta, whereas in the previous one it was theta, whereas here in the double rotation it is 2 theta. And it is used. And the value of that composes at a faster rate as compared to the previous one. So these are the results, once again, which I have done for performance analysis with the expression. And I got the value of sine as 0.000005 for sine and 0.000014 for cos. And you see that the relative error, the value is very lesser for double rotation as compared to interval arithmetic quadratic. And here I also found accuracy evaluation. So accuracy evaluation using mathematical analysis also we can find. But using mathematical analysis, what is happens is due to the non-linear characteristics of mathematics expression, we don't get accurate results. So in order to get these accurate results, we have been for statistical method, which is nothing but mean absolute percentage error, which is given by the expression 1 upon n sigma I is 1 to n AR minus FI divided by AI. So I have made a comparison of both the algorithms, and here this mean absolute percentage error is a forecast of the error. So which gives the error in this fashion. For simplicity, I just calculated for the equation 6, 10 and 12. The reason why I have chosen 6, 10 and 12 is for interval rotation coordinate at iteration number 12, the z component decomposes to 0. Whereas in for a double coordinate, the decomposition of the algorithm was only at iteration number 7. So I have chosen iterations between 6 and 12 so that I can accommodate 7 as well as 12. And this is the table. We see that for IA coordinate at double rotation, IA double coordinate. And we see that in double rotation IA coordinate, the value is lesser, 2.20 for cos and 6.1 for sine. And here we see the percentage value is very much lesser. The lesser made indicates better percentage. But lesser percentage rule, better made. And these are the time and iteration parameters. I have put a table and I have shown the maximum iteration. So the maximum iteration for interval arithmetic quadratic was 12, whereas interval arithmetic double quadratic was 7. And the execution time was 3.236 seconds for quadratic. And whereas for double quadratic, it is 2.595 seconds. And relative error for sine 45 is, we can see the value is 0.000168 as well as for double cortic, it is 0.00005. You see, if you compare both the values, we give the lesser value for double cortic. So lesser value indicates better MIF. Better MIF indicates a good percentage and the increase in performance. And this is a bar graph which we got from MATLAB Toolbox Unit Lab, which gives time iterations of individual algorithms. We see here both algorithms and the comparison between time and iteration. So these are the outcomes. The outcomes are improvement in computational accuracy, reduction of computational latency, reduction of hardware complexity, and improvement of performance. And the applications are digital. We can use these concepts in digital signal processing, digital image processing, and direct and inverse kinematics computation for robot manipulation. And we can also use for planar and 3D vector rotation for graphics and animation. And now there is a trend also which they use for radar signal processing, neural network, wireless devices, robotics, etc. And these are some of the references. So these are some of the references.
Hello.
Thank you. Yeah, ma'am, tell me.
Yeah. What is the computational complexity in terms of number of add multiply that is involved in implementation of algorithm?
Madam, here we don't come across in quartic multiplication. There is no multiplier unit.
Add and shift, so, whatever.
Only shift and add. It does everything using shift and add. So hence we can reduce the hardware complexity because we know that multiplication takes huge amount of space. And here we are reducing the multiplication factor using only shift and add. And we can say that we can read. So with the advent of VLSI and EDA tools, many hardware effective algorithms came into picture. So out of this, one of the most effective and popularly used is quartic because it doesn't use any multiplier. It does the process of multiplication only using shift and add.
Then what is the number of gates involved or what is the hardware that is involved for making the computation?
Madam, here we come across only shift and add.
Correct.
And
so what is the different types of hardware that you have checked so that you say that it is computationally efficient?
Yes, ma'am. So we have table lookup methods as well as polynomial approximation methods. In table lookup method, which is nothing but we can have lookup table. The lookup table can be either bigger or smaller. If the lookup table is smaller, the error involved is more. If the lookup table is bigger, the precision will be bigger, but memory consumption is more. When the memory consumption is more, and we know memory is expensive. And the second one is scalar expansion method. We know, for example, we know the expression, let's say sin x is equal to x minus x cubed divided by 3 plus x raised to 5 divided by 5. So there we come across powers, division as well as multiplication. If you wanted more, as the power has been increasing, then obviously the requirement for the hardware is more. Hence, so rather than using the scalar approximation method, we are using quartic. The same thing we can implement in quartic using shift and add.
Correct. Have you checked anything on some equations or something for validation? How have you done this?
Madam, I have gone through for relative errors. As well as
my question is, have you checked this for on any expression in signal processing?
Yes, ma'am. Signal processing, with respect to signal processing, currently I am working for biomedical signal processing. So my work is on biomedical signal. So FFT, I am validating that.
Hello. Yes. Would you specify anything, any specific interval between iterations? You have mentioned in one of your table, it indicates it is between 6 and 12.
Yes,
ma'am. Is there any specific reason for that?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. What's the reason? Yes, ma'am. I'll come back to the table. Madam, here we see mean absolute percentage error. There I have shown iteration number 6, 10 and 12. So for interval arithmetic quadratic method, and the value of z decomposed at iteration number 12. Whereas for double rotation quadratic, the z value decomposed to 0 at iteration number 6. Hence, I have taken the beginning iteration as 12 and the ending beginning as 6 and the ending as 12. So because one I got at 6, one I got at 12. So in between I have taken 6 and 12, and in between I have taken 6.
Is there a scope for the change in this interval?
Interval in the sense of interval.
My question is, should that necessarily be 6 and 12? Or can it be anything else? It depends on the value that you get, right?
Madam, here, if you see the architecture of us, so we have X component, Y component, and Z component. So in the Z component, as decomposed when it was iteration number 6. So I got at iteration number 6, I got the result of sign and cos. So further, I need not go for further iteration when I got the result. When I got the result for sign and cos, I just stopped at that point.
Okay. So in one of the answers that you were giving, you were mentioning that your multiplication is justified in terms of successive addition, right?
Successive addition.
Yeah. It depends on the number of adders that you use. So how do you claim that, or how do you justify that there is reduction of hardware?
Madam, so with respect to hardware efficient algorithms, as we have discussed earlier, we came across table lookup methods, we come across polynomial approximation methods. If you compare these two, so ours is a better one. We use only shift and add, whereas in polynomial Taylor series, polynomial expressions, we know the better, the best known example is Taylor series.
Okay. Ma'am, my question to you is, in terms of hardware, the number of adders, how do you justify that when you realize it in terms of the hardware components?
It happens to see in the block diagram, so we use only three adder a shifter block, adder 1, adder 2, and adder, each one for one component. So let's say X component, one adder, Y component, one adder, Z component, and one. Only three adders are sufficient for us.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Sugandha.
Thank you.
So your session is over. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hello.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Hello.
Ayushi, can you hear me? Can you see me?
Yes,
ma'am. Yeah, you are not audible. Be a little louder.
Yeah, ma'am. I can see you. You are audible.
But we should also be able to hear you.
Bit louder.
Yeah, a bit louder, please. Yeah.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yeah. So, I'll introduce you to our session chairs. We have Dr. Aarti R. Shankar, Associate Professor, Department of ECU with us. And we have Dr. M. N. Suma, again Associate Professor, Department of ECU, BMSC. You can introduce yourself and start your presentation.
Ma'am, I am Aarti Sharma, Assistant Professor, ECU Department, Royal Khan University, Bareilly.
Could you be please louder a bit? Just hold the mic a little closer to you. Yeah.
Yeah. I am Anshi Sharma.
You're still not audible.
Hello.
Not clear enough.
Increase
the volume.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Yeah, oh, slightly better, but we cannot. The volume is still less. Yeah. Okay. Keep very close to you.
Hello. Yeah, ma'am, it's very close. Yeah, hello. You're not audible. Hello.
Okay.
Hello.
Yeah. Continue, please. Continue. Yeah.
Hello.
Speak a little louder. Please. Yeah.
Yeah, are you audible? Are you getting my voice?
Sort of, yeah.
Yeah, faintly audible.
Hello, good afternoon, ma'am.
Yeah, please
this
continue.
This is IC Sharma, Assistant Professor of Rural Khan University, Bareilly EC Department. Yeah, and I'm here to present my paper on the topic Privacy Enhancement of Optical CDMA Network by using various encryption schemes. These are the contents: Introduction, Literature Survey, Optical CDMA, Optical Orthogonal Codes, Types of Encoding Techniques, Conclusion, and References. Optical CDMA. In introduction, I have basically defined about optical CDMA. It is a mixed technique of version of optical communication with the CDMA technology, where we have extracted the bandwidth efficiency of optical CDMA with the code word efficiency of CDMA technology. Are you getting my voice, ma'am? Yeah, okay. Various modulation schemes are used in this optical CDMA network, that is orthogonal optical codes, on-off keying modulation, two-code keying, and multi-code keying modulation. These are the papers that I had reviewed in my present my paper, that is spread spectrum fiber optic local area network, which showed that CDMA can be implemented on optical fibers also. And the paper called Optical Orthogonal Codes Design, Analysis and Applications, proposed an OCDMA network architecture using the optical orthogonal code with required autocorrelation and correlation properties. And these are the papers that showed the security defined by the optical orthogonal codes, that is security performance of optical CDMA against eavesdropping, Journal of Lightwave Technology. And the next paper shows how we can increase the encryption such that the eavesdropper could not get our coded versions of a signal that is sent from the receiver to the transmitter. What is optical CDMA? Optical CDMA permits various users to access the network resources asynchronously. Means like in TDMA or in FDMA, where the every user needs some time slot or a frequency slot to send their message to the channel. But in optical CDMA, we use code words. We define code words to every user such that they can send their signal from the receiver to the transmitter. But with the help of optical communication, this CDMA technique gets the wider bandwidth and high security to the signal that is sent from the receiver to the transmitter. This is the block diagram of this optical CDMA system. The data that is taken from the source is being optically encoded, and a star coupler is used to like multiplex the data from the receiver to the transmitter, and that at the receiver side, the optical decoder is used to decode the optical data such that the receiver could get the decrypted version of that sent data. What are optical orthogonal codes? The data codes are being converted into the light wave and then encrypted or zored with the key bit, that is PN sequence that is generated at the transmitter side is being zored with the data bit such that it can be encrypted, such that the receiver could not get the code words easily. These are some autocorrelation and cross-correlation properties used in an optical CDMA network, where autocorrelation property is basically used at the receiver side such that the data that is received or the data that is transmitted can be auto, matlab, the data that is transmitted and the keywords that we had on the receiver side can be autocorrelated to generate a pulse that is used to like that is used to decrypt the data properly. And the cross-correlation property is used at the transmitter side such that the other signals, the data that we have seen could not be mixed with the signals that are nearby them. These are the various security schemes that is need to be noted down, that is like confidentiality, integrity and availability. Their confidentiality denotes the information which is available to the unlicensed user. The confidentiality should be increased so that the data cannot be decrypted easily by the eavesdropper. Availability, data being available and usable on demand by an unauthorized person. That an unauthorized person could not easily take our data. Like the various encoding schemes that are used are like one dimensional coding, where that one digital one is defined with a one code word and the zero bit is defined with no code words. Second scheme is like two dimensional coding, where one is denoted by a code word and zero is denoted by another code word. And third, we have used a multi-coding scheme where m data bits per symbol is used to denote the 2^m code matrices is used to denote the m data bits per symbol. Previously, the electro-optics were designed to encrypt the data words and the code words. But we have a problem with that we use an electrical wire with the data and the keywords, which produces the magnetic field and the data is, and we get a problem with the loss of data. And now we are dealing with the all optic design where we do not use any electrical wires and the data is being secured over here. In all optic design, first diagram shows the drawing of the data bits and the key bits to encrypt the data that is shown by the E of I. And that E of I is multiplexed with the optical code words at CJ or CJ1, which selects the one code word according to the bit that is encrypted bits. Here we can see the simulation setup of all optic XOR gate and a CMUX simulation setup. The data bits D0 and K0 are shown over here. Like D0 has 0101100110, and the keywords like 110101010. We can see when we are XORing the data bits and key bits, we are getting the encrypted bits as shown like 1. 0000100,
We can see over the diagram, we can see from the graph that we have got the encrypted with the data bits and the key bits to get the encrypted bits over here. And according to the encrypted bits, the code words are also defined over here. Code words are also defined, like one is given the code word C1 and zero is given the code word C0, like this C1, C0, C0. Here we can see the gap over here. C1 is defined with a power, and C0 is defined with no power, such that C0, C0, C0 is a gap, and then C1 is a code word, C1 is a code word, and we can see C0 is a gap, and then C1 is a code word, then C0 and C0. Simulation setup of we can see here the the output of a multiplexer. We can see here the output of a multiplexer like C1, C0, 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 and then C1, C1, then C0, then C1, then C0, C0. To increase the confidentiality of our code word, we have firstly defined the two code keying. Then we have defined the four code keying such that our data and the key bits should be increased such that the eavesdropper could not easily decrypt our data. Like four code keying, here we have used 8 code, then it can be increased up to 6 code keying. The data bits like D1 and D0. In the next slide, the data bits like D1, D0 and K1, K0 is 2 raised for n modulo added. It is 2 raised for n modulo added, like 0 plus 3 can be written is equals to x plus 1 can be written as 3, where 1 plus 1 like in 0 of D1, D0, 0 of D1, D0 is modulo 2 added, modulo 2 is for 2 added with 3, that is equal to x plus 1, that is equals to 3, and d1 d0 of 1 of d1 d0 with 3 with 1 of k1 k0 is modulo 2 is for 2 added, and we can get here 0, such that we get all the encrypted bits like modulo 2 is for 2 added. And we define the code words according to the encrypted bits like this.
Aishi, I guess you have crossed the time. Oh, 10 minutes from now.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
So probably you can conclude.
Yeah, ma'am. And in the conclusion, we can say that the better communication is achieved when we encrypt the data with a more number of data bits and key bits. And when we increase the code word in length such that the data cannot be decrypted easily at the receiver side, by the eavesdropper.
Okay.
Thanks.
Hello.
Hello.
My question is, what is the execution time or simulation time required for implementation?
It is simulation time means, can you please elaborate your question?
Yeah, for given data length to encode it, what will be the time required for encoding, and then for decrypting, what will be the time required? How many number of bits and iteration you are considering?
For encoding, that code words are encrypted with 20 bits. That code words we have used that 20 bits, and at last it is like 25 gigabits per second time used in that.
Is there any side information transmitted for requirement of side information to be transmitted for the receiver to know, or how is the decoding happen at the receiver?
The side bit, the PN generation, PN sequence that is in given to the transmitter side is also given to the receiver side, such that it can easily decrypt the data.
So what will be the acquisition time, because it is CDMA that you are telling, how the acquisition of the system will happen, what is the time for synchronization and acquisition, how many bits are reserved for that?
Because
receiver has to acquire and then get synchronized, right?
Yeah.
Otherwise, decoding will not be proper.
Yeah. For that, we'll give some extra redundant bits before the data and after the data, such that the synchronization can be maintained at the receiver side.
That is the thing. How many bits is used for that? Because it will again become a burden, right? Transmission burden. How many bits do you have reserved for sync?
No such bits are reserved here.
Only the encoding and decoding you have done, not actual transmission. Not actual.
No actual transmission.
Okay. Hello, Ayush, my question to you is, would there not be delay involved in your simulation setup? Have you can you account for the delay? How much of delay do you anticipate?
No, ma'am. The delayed is anticipated, but the delayed is compensated with the data rates of code words and the encrypted words.
No, what is the anticipated delay? Of course, you said you have not transmitted or received, right? It's a simulation setup.
Yes.
You would have expected something,
yes,
right? The predicted delay.
Yes.
Was there any predicted delay?
No, ma'am. As such, I don't know about it.
Okay. And do you think, if you have not considered the channel, then there's no question of what about the losses that occur in the medium? You've used the optical medium, right? Any idea about the losses that can occur in the medium?
Yeah, it depends upon the mode of the optical network that is used in over here. And as such, I have not...
Okay.
These are the some banding losses or optical fiber